This is the eighth message tonight in a series on the second coming of Christ, a subject which I feel is of great weight in our day. In my own judgment, the church at large has forgotten that Jesus is coming again. Mm-hmm. I can tell by the way they live. I can tell by the way they preach. I can tell by the literature. I can tell by the bookstores. Somehow the sense of Christ's coming has vacated. It's not present. Now, there's a lot of erroneous teaching about Christ's coming, and I don't want to deal with it because it's rather depressing to deal with. But one reason why people have a distorted view of Christ's coming is because they don't know how he's going to come in power and great glory. Mm-hmm. That's what I want to deal with tonight. Christ's coming is going to be with power and great glory. Now, I'll briefly take a moment here to define glory. He's used a number of ways in Scripture. Let him with a glory in the Lord. That's one sense of glory. The psalmist referred to his tongue as his glory. It's your glory too. Paul said one place a woman's hair was her glory. And Jesus has been glorified. Mm-hmm. God's glorified him. He's in glory. So there's a number of ways it's used. I'm referring now to divine glory, to Christ's glory. The word glory, if you look at it etymologically or from the standpoint of language, it means heavy. Of course, that doesn't mean anything to the average person. But what it means is that when Jesus Christ is seen as he is, it outweighs everything else. When you can see Jesus plainly, you really can't see anybody else. Nobody else makes a difference. When God shows up on the scene, no one's concerned about anybody else. Amen. That's just the way it is. There have been a few times in history when people knew God was present, and when they did, he did have their attention, let me tell you. There was no question about it. And what I want to declare tonight is that Jesus Christ is going to come not just in some glory, he's going to come in all of his glory.
That's right.
He's not only going to come in his glory, he's going to come in the glory of his Father. He's not only going to come in all of his glory and all the glory of the Father, he's going to come in all the glory of the angels. That's a heap of glory, let me tell you.
Amen.
And there isn't anybody going to rush out to fight him.
Amen.
That is one of the biggest absurdities in the world, I will tell you. I think when God hears things like that, he laughs and has people in derision. It's such foolishness. It's spoken of. Glory. Now, glory. Now, but what is that? What does all this mean? God's glory is when who he is manifested or made known. I like some of these old English words. Speech in our day has been dumbed down. So the words don't mean very much. This is the land of the Ebonic language. And people have dumbed down speech. A good word like manifest, it means the thing has been made known.
That's right.
That is, it's unquestionable. That is, people don't... There's going to come a time when people aren't going to theorize about what God's like and Christ is like. They're going to see it.
Yes.
There's going to be no question about it. Now, let me go to the scripture here on this. One of the few men in all of human history that asked God to show him his glory was Moses, who was one of the premier people in the history of humanity. Moses, he is described as faithful in all God's house. Mm-hmm. Hebrews, the third chapter. Mm-hmm. Now Moses, after he had confronted God already, and it liked to scare everybody else to death, after he had seen God at Sinai, after he'd heard him at Sinai, after they'd had dialogue at Sinai, Exodus, the 33rd chapter, the dialogue with God began in the 19th chapter, so there's been a lot of exposure up to this point. Here's what Moses said, "I beseech thee, show me thy glory." And he, that's God, God answered. One thing to talk to God is another thing for him to answer. That's that. That's another matter. Moses was one of the people God answered. He said, I will make all my goodness pass before thee. I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and will show mercy unto whom I will show mercy. Remember, now Moses said, show me your glory, and here's what he talked about. He talked about his character, what he really was. And he said, thou canst not see my face and live, for there shall no man see me and live. The Lord said, behold, there's a place by me. Thou shalt stand upon a rock, and it shall come to pass, when my glory passes by, that I will put thee in a cleft or split of the rock, and will cover thee with my hand as I pass by. And I will take away my hand, and thou shalt see my back parts. That's after he's already gone by. There's like an afterglow. Thou shalt see my back parts, but my face shall not be seen. Now, what is it? Remember, Moses, show me your glory, and God said, I'm going to make my glory pass by. Now, I'm defining glory here. I'm showing that glory is just not a dazzling appearance. It's an appearance that tells something. It's an intelligent appearance. The 34th chapter of Exodus, this happened. What God just told Moses would happen, happened. And the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him, that's Moses, there, and proclaimed the name of the Lord. Now remember, he said, I'm going to make my glory pass by. And here's what God said. The Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children's children, unto the third and fourth generation. Now this is glory we're talking about. God's telling him what he's like. Now note that as these qualities were going to become apparent. This was what the kingdom of God's not in word. 1 Corinthians 4:20 says it's not just talk. God was going to show this. This was going to come out, and Moses would be able to visibly see this and come to this conclusion. When he saw God's glory, this is what God was like. Now God had told Moses in the 33rd chapter, 20th verse, you can't see my face, for no man can see me and live. So you couldn't see just a head-on God and see all this. It'd kill you. That's what he said. Now speaking of Christ, remember, here's the glory. It's who he really is, what he really does, how he conducts himself among people. The people don't know this. It's the job of the church to proclaim this. God conducts himself in a certain way when he's in the presence of people. He's drawn to people that have pure hearts. He is repulsed by people that do not. Well, I'll tell you, this is not taught in any places, but this is the way it is. And people are going to see it when Jesus comes. There's not going to be one happy sinner when Jesus comes. There's not going to be one sad saint when he comes. This is the way God is. And he showed Moses a little glimpse of this. Now, the scriptures tell us that God is, in fact, going to unveil Jesus fully, like he unveiled himself partially to Moses. This is declared in 1 Timothy 6:16. Speaking of Jesus, it says that he only has immortality, dwelling in light which no man can approach to, whom no man has seen nor can see, to whom be honor and power everlasting. So that Jesus has qualities that can't be seen, just like God had qualities that couldn't be seen by a person and live. Glory has to do with who God is being made known. Now, flesh can't receive this. Flesh can't receive this. A person who's in the body could never go and talk to a glorified Christ. You really got to be able to see this. This could not happen. That's what God is telling Moses. This can't happen. So what you're going to see, you're going to see like the afterglow. I'm going to pass by, and you're going to kind of see the afterglow. You can't really see me as I am. You can't see Jesus as he is while you're in this body. But when he comes, we are all going to really see him as he is, which means things aren't going to be like they are now. Now, Revelation 20 and verse 11 confirm this. John said, I saw a great white throne, him that sat upon it, from whose face the heaven and earth fled away, and no place was found for them. So even nature's, not all of nature's, not going to be able to survive the glory of God when it's unveiled. Now, this is the matter of Revelation now. This is an interpretation. This is what the text says. It's going to flee from before God's presence. So we learn a few things about God's glory. It has to do with who he is, his real person, becoming very apparent, so there's no question about it. See, people today argue about, is God, does God love? Does God hate? Does God have wrath? Is God? They speculate about it. But when he's made known, nobody's going to be speculating about it. So if you want to know what God's like, you better find out in this world. While you're in this world, you better find out.
Amen.
Because the scripture says when Jesus comes, he's going to destroy those that know not God and obey not the gospel. So this is our time. You've got 70 years, and if by reason of strength 80, to find out what God's like. Because if you don't know, you won't survive. It's just that, it's that cut and dried. And I would like to have a few choruses on that written today. Now let's look at some limited displays of God's glory. Some limited, where you just kind of pulled back a little bit of the curtain and let's see a little bit of his glory and what effect it had. One of them, of course, is Mount Sinai. Mount Sinai. Here's what Habakkuk, you know who Habakkuk was, you know, you, when you get to heaven, you want to be able to at least be acquainted with who Habakkuk was. Habakkuk, he commented on Sinai. The details of it are found in Exodus 19. All the way up through 34. Here's what he said. Habakkuk 3:3-5. God came from Teman, and the Holy One from Mount Paran. Selah. That means think on that for a while. His glory covered the heavens, and earth was full of his praise. And his brightness was as the light. He had horns coming out of his hand, and there was the hiding of his power. Before him went the pestilence, and burning coals went forth at his feet. The earth shook, the heavens and also dropped at the presence of God. Even Sinai itself was moved at the presence of the God of Israel. That Sinaitic peninsula lit up like the noonday sun. There were thunderclouds and tempests and hurricane blasts and hail falling and fire, and the whole mountain's on a smoke. The ground was shaken. Moses said, I exceedingly fear and quake. And that's just a little bit of God's glory. In fact, the scriptures depicted it as his feet touching the mountain. And it just like to fell apart right there. Now, I'm showing you that nature can't survive the glory of God. The psalmist said this in Psalm 68:8, speaking of this limited view of God's glory. The earth shook, the heavens also dropped at the presence of God, even Sinai itself was moved at the presence of God, the God of Israel. So, and nobody in all Israel said, what's going on? Nobody rushed out and said, what is this? Is this some kind of weather phenomenon? They all knew God was there. And nobody sinned at that time. They had to wait till the glory left before they started their revelry at Mount Sinai. It was after the glory left. Nobody did it when it was there. All right, that's one view. Now, Isaiah is a man who saw the glory of the Lord. Limited view of the glory of God. Let's see how it affected him. This is Isaiah 6:1. In the day that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord also sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train, the train of his garment, the tailing part of his garment, filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphim. Each one had 6 wings. With 20 he covered his face. with twain, or two he covered his feet, with twain he did fly. One cried to another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. There it is. They knew it, but the people on earth didn't know it. And the posts of the door moved. And at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with a smoke. Well, Isaiah, what do you think of that? He said, Woe is me! I'm a man, I'm undone. I'm a man of unclean lips and dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for mine eyes have seen the Lord of the King, the Lord of hosts. Well, actually, he just saw a very abbreviated picture, but it undid him. You know what would happen in the average church if all of a sudden acute awareness of God was among them? Why, you wouldn't be able to recognize. You wouldn't be able to recognize a service. Corinthians, the book of Corinthians talked about one man, in the 14th chapter of 1 Corinthians, one man came into one meeting and he sensed the presence of God and he fell on his face and said, God's in you of a truth, and his heart convicted him. That's an example of what happens when people know God is present. I will tell you, with all this modern thrust of emphasis on praise and so forth, what I'm seeing, I'm very concerned about this and could say a lot more. I'm going to cut this very short. There is not enough of an awareness of God. There's too much sloppy living, sloppy looking, sloppy thinking. I can tell the people don't know God's there. And they're lying when they say they do. Because we know in Scripture what happens when you know God's present. When you know He is, you straighten up your act, and you do it right now. Now, the truth of the matter is, He is here, but not in all His glory. See, that's the catch. Well, there's another man in Scripture, Jacob. He confronted the Lord just a little bit of abbreviated glory, just a little peek when he wrestled with a man from heaven, you remember? In Genesis 32:30, here's what Jacob said. He said, I've seen God face to face. Then my life is preserved. I live through it. Well, he didn't see God in all his glory. He didn't see him in the glory even that Moses saw him at Sinai. He wrestled with an angel. The Scripture says it was an angel. He wrestled with an angel who, you know, kind of held back. He had to hold back when he was wrestling with Jacob. And Jacob said, I survived the encounter. Yeah, that's how he felt about it. Israel, here's what they said. They saw this just abbreviated, limited exposure to glory. Deuteronomy 5:24, Moses reminded the people, you said, Behold, the Lord our God has showed us his glory and his greatness, and we've heard his voice out of the midst of the fire. We've seen this day the God to talk with man, and he lives. Now therefore, why should we die? For this great fire will consume us if we hear the voice of the Lord our God any more than we shall die. That was their conclusion, huh? That was their conclusion. Now, I don't know what a seeker-friendly type situation to do with that, but they thought they were going to die if God spoke any more. That's how it affected them. And one more, I'm giving you another example from Judges 13:22. This is Manoah. Manoah, that's Samson's father. And an angel from the Lord appeared and told Manoah they were going to have a son. He was going to be Samson. He was going to be a Nazarite. And they told him how to raise Samson. And after the affair was over, here's what Manoah said. After this brief confrontation with a representative from heaven, we shall surely die because we've seen God. Well, we don't have to say any more about that. It shows that God's glory has to do with you're acutely aware of Him. There's no question He's present. And even in these very limited revelations of God, it frightened people. They thought they were going to die. And God just wouldn't come right out and said, you will die. If I just pull back the curtain and you see me as I am, you will. That's just the truth. That's glory. Now let's get to the matter of Christ when he comes. He's going to come in glory. Great power and glory. Let's first of all view what Jesus himself said about his return and in relation to glory. Matthew 19:28, Jesus said unto them, Verily I say unto you, that ye which have followed me in the regeneration, when the Son of Man shall sit in the throne of his glory, you shall also sit upon 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Now I'm going to come back on these texts. I just want to show here, his coming is going to be in glory. Here they're going to see, he's going to be obviously the king. There's going to be no competition. Everyone's going to know he is the king. He's going to sit in his throne of glory. How he really is. Let's take another text. Matthew 25:31. The Son of Man shall come in his glory. Matthew 16:27. The Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels. And then he shall reward every man according to his work. Mark 8:38. Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous generation, sinful generation, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he comes in his glory. There's a text that he's going to come in his glory. Some texts say he's going to come in great power in glory. A big display that's unquestionable. See? Not going to be veiled.
Amen.
Matthew 24:30. Then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn when they shall see the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. Mark 13:26. They shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with great power and glory. Luke 21:27. They shall see the Son of Man coming in the cloud with power and great glory. So Jesus is making this pretty clear. And people who are familiar with Scripture, when God made himself known, even by an angel, everybody knew what was happening. Now, talk about glory. He's going to come in all of his glory, the Father's glory, the angel's glory. This is Luke 9:26. You notice coming is always singular. No place does the Lord say, I'm going to come two more times. Even though Tim LaHaye says he is. It's always one more coming. Never does it say, I'm going to come two more times. I'm going to sneak in once, and then I'm going to come public. See, this is a lot of hokum. This is not true. God's going to unveil him one more time, that's all. Here's what the Scripture says, Luke 9:26. The Son of Man shall come in his own glory, and in his Father's, and of the holy angels, and there's an innumerable company of angels. Just one angel showed up at Sennacherib's army and killed 185,000 overnight. Just one. The angels were present at Sinai, frightened everybody. Think of all of them at one time, with all of their glory coming, and the Father who veiled his glory at Sinai and veiled it to Isaiah and all of his glory, and Jesus in all of his glory. That's what Jesus said, he's going to come like that. Those are Christ's words. Let's look at the apostolic words about Jesus coming in glory. Colossians 3:4, when Christ who is our life shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Again, 1 Peter 4:13. Rejoice inasmuch as you are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy.
Amen.
That's going to be the telling moment. It's going to be the telling moment. We may not be able to figure out now who's in, who's out. But there'll be no question when Jesus unveils his glory. There'll be no question who's in, who's out. There won't be. There'll be nobody who's in crying for rocks and mountains to fall on. Mm-hmm. And there'll be nobody out saying, we're glad to see you, Jesus. It just isn't going to happen. Again, 2 Thessalonians 1:7. And to you who are troubled, rest with us when the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels. Actually, the Father is going to show Jesus, but unveiled. See, God's glorified Christ now. He's glorified now, but is not seen.
Mm-hmm.
But 1 Timothy 6:15 says, in his own time, that God's own times, he will show or manifest or make known who is the blessed only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords. He's going to remove all doubt Anybody going to be putting Jesus on par with Muhammad or Joseph Smith or something like this? It isn't going to happen. But he unveils his glory. That's going to be it. Everybody's going to know who he is.
Amen.
And then John said, "Beloved, we are the sons of God. It doth not yet appear what we shall be, but when he shall appear, and we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is." That's glory. We have Jesus talking about coming in glory and seeing him as he really is. And the other apostles taught this too. Now, what is the impact of this glory? What's going to happen when Jesus comes in all of his glory? There's no question he's going to come in glory. Mm-hmm. Not going to come concealed. He came the first time concealed. He's not coming a second time that way. Well, here's the impact. Then, every man's going to receive his own reward. Now here's what it says, Matthew 16:27. "The Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he shall reward every man according as his work shall be." You can't really say it any plainer. You can look at it in the Greek and it still says the same thing. You can check any other version you want to check, from cotton patch to the old time one. Check them all, and there's no question what he says. Every man, not some men, everybody is going to receive the reward for their work. They're going to reap what they sowed.
Yes.
Everybody, when Jesus comes in his glory. And we only know of one other time he's going to come, and that's in his glory. Mm-hmm. Again, this is going to be called, this is the time of the regeneration. When Jesus comes in his glory, the heavens and the earth are going to be regenerated. Jesus referred to the time as the regeneration. That's what he called it. It's found in Matthew 19:28. Jesus said unto them, "Verily I say unto you, that ye which have followed me in the regeneration, when the Son of Man shall sit on the throne of his glory, you shall sit upon 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel." That was the 12 apostles. Quite a picture. The regeneration. Now, there's a little bit more about this in Scripture, the regeneration. Peter said, "We look for a new heavens and a new earth wherein dwells righteousness." That's a regeneration, because it's not dwelling in the one we're in now. That's for sure. Romans 8:21 says about creation, the whole creation, said it's groaning and waiting to be delivered from the bondage of corruption. That's the regeneration, when it's going to be delivered from the bondage of corruption. So that no one's going to be able to go to Washington, D.C. after Jesus comes. I'm sorry, but this isn't going to happen. This earth's not going to be able to survive.
Amen.
The return of Christ in all his glory. The only way this earth could survive is maybe if he enters as an infant, a little infant wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger, all right, the earth could survive that entrance. Mm-hmm. But it can't survive the next. We know it's the case, Revelation 20:11. Says it is the case that the heaven and earth will flee mm-hmm. away. Mm-hmm. So the regeneration, that's going to happen. When Christ comes in all of his glory, that glory is going to change everything. And when he comes in his glory, the tribes of the earth, we might call them ethnic groups or nations, they're going to mourn. There isn't anybody going to say, which is the true religion? Is it the Muslims, or is it the Shintoists, or is it the Hindus, or the Buddhists? Nobody's going to say this. When Jesus comes again, here's what he said, Matthew 24:30. "Then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. Then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, when they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with power and great glory." So the thinking of everybody about Jesus is going to be adjusted. But it's going to be too late to make a moral change. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. When Jesus comes again, there's going to be no one's character is going to be changed. You're going to be locked into whatever you are. Well, it's going to be, "Let him that's filthy be filthy still. Let him the holy be holy still." It's going to be locked in because the glory going to have that kind of an impact. Revelation 1:7 speaks of the same thing. "Behold, he comes with clouds, every eye shall see him, and they that pierced him have also was pierced him, and the kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him." That's the same as mourn because of him. So that's something going to happen when Jesus comes in his glory. That's not all. When he comes in his glory, there's going to be a separation. Mm-hmm. Going to be a separation of the saved and the lost, the righteous and the unrighteous, the sheep and the goats, the sons of God and the sons of Belial. There's going to be a separation of wheat and the tares. They're not going to be together anymore. Mm-mm. Here's what Jesus said, Matthew 25:31. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory, and before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another as a sheep divides a shepherd divides a sheep from the goats. You can't get any plainer than this. This is what he says he's going to do. Amen. Separate the sheep and the goats. You redo that text, eternity is at stake, because it says, enter thou into the joy of the Lord and depart and be cursed into everlasting fire. That says, so it's not separation, just the saints go there and the wicked stay here. When there's a separation, the wicked go to hell and the saved go with Christ. That's the separation he's talking about when he comes in his glory. That's very specific about it. Again, Jesus said that he's going to be ashamed of an unbelieving generation when he comes in his glory. Until then, like, the door of salvation is open. Whosoever will may come. But when Jesus comes in his glory, that door is shut. That's going to be it. Mark 8:38. Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with his holy angels. So there's no question about when this is. Maybe, you know, sometime maybe people are tempted to be ashamed of what Christ said in the middle of a sinful and adulterous generation. They say, well, they don't believe it anyway, I just won't say it, you know. Well, now Jesus, going on record here, says, when I come in my glory, I'll be ashamed of whoever was ashamed of me in my words. And like, you don't, no one here is foolish enough to think a person Jesus is ashamed of will go to heaven. I mean, surely nobody thinks this. Again, Luke 9:26, whosoever shall be ashamed of me and of my words, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he shall come in his own glory and his Father's and the holy angels. Now, what else is going to happen? Jesus looks at this from another angle. When he comes in his glory, he's going to send his angels and gather his people from one end of heaven to one end of earth. He's going to gather them all together. This is Mark 13:26-27. And then you shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory, and he shall send his angels and shall gather his elect from the four winds, from the uttermost part of earth to the uttermost part of heaven. Just what he says. When's he going to do that? When he comes in his glory. When is he going to come in his glory? The next time he comes. That's the second time. That's when he's going to come in his glory. We're all going to be together then. You're going to gather together all that. Ephesians 1:10 says that God's eternal purpose is to gather together into one things that are in earth and things in heaven. And here he tells you when it's going to happen. It's going to happen when Jesus comes with his angels in his glory and in the Father's glory. God hasten the day. Now Jesus told his disciples that this coming of Christ in his glory is to be connected with our redemption, those that are in Christ. Luke 21:27-28. Then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. When these things begin to come to pass, look up, lift up your heads, your redemption draws nigh. Well, you don't want to let somebody tell you, when these things begin to come to pass, watch out, the Antichrist is about here. Well, no, the Antichrist may be about here, but that's not what we're thinking. That's not what we're thinking about.
Amen.
We're thinking about redemption's nigh.
That's right.
Not destruction. That's not what he said. God's not appointed us to wrath. but to obtain salvation. It's going to, the fullness of it is coming when Jesus comes. These are the words of Jesus now. This is what he said. He didn't say, well, these things begin to come to pass, get scared. Now, there'll be people getting scared. Now, make no mistake about this, but not God's people.
Amen.
The others have every right to get scared. They really do. Again, Colossians 3:4. Well, we're showing here the impact of his glory. What's going to happen when he comes in his glory? When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall we also appear with him in glory. See, now we are, we're incognito right now. We're like in disguise. You can't really tell, just by appearance, you can't really tell like who's in, who's out. Who's the sons of God and who's not. So unless you're with them for a while, you can't tell. But on that day, when Jesus, when everybody really sees who Jesus is, everybody's going to really see who we are. Oh, what a thought that is. Now, there'll probably have to be a lot of adjusting of thinking, but that's the way it's going to be. You want to make sure you live. Well, you can't say this too strongly. You want to make sure that you live so that when Jesus comes, you'll show up as being one of his.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And now he gets you all you need to actually live that way.
Yes.
Now when Jesus comes again in all of his glory, with his Father's glory, with the holy angels, the wicked are going to get punished. Mm-hmm. He's not coming to fight with the wicked.
That's right.
He's going to destroy the wicked one with the breath of his mouth. Mm-hmm. That's it. Mm-hmm. All over. All God has to do is show up and the battle's done.
Amen.
You just check out Scripture and see if this isn't the case. When God showed up, turmoil's done.
That's
right. 2 Thessalonians 1, 7-10. You who are troubled, rest with us. Don't be overly concerned about the troubles that are going on around about us. And we're living where there are a lot of troubles going on around about us. From terrorists to hurricane to tornado to flood. It's, we see it. Oh, don't be troubled. Don't be troubled. Rest with us when the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels. What's a hurricane to a mighty angel or a terrorist? In flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God. When's that going to happen? When Jesus is revealed from heaven. That's going to happen. Taking vengeance on them that know not God, that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power, when he shall come to be glorified in his saints and to be admired in all in that believe.
Amen.
Because our testimony was believed by you in that day. And that's what's going to happen. When we're glad to see him, that's the time the wicked are going to be punished. Mm-hmm. Now, whatever a person's theology is about end times, you better make room to be able to say this. You better be able to say this without the tongue in your cheek. And whatever you may think about the punishment of the wicked, whatever you may think about it, when Jesus shows up and is seen as he is, the day of the wicked is over. There will not be 1 second more of any trouble from the wicked. If God could subdue Amen. Wickedness by his foot touching Sinai, you can imagine what's going to happen when all the Father's glory, all the Son's glory, and all the glory of the holy angels, when it's made known, it's a day of destruction for the wicked. At the same time, we're going to be glorifying God and admiring, oh, this is, he's just exactly what I thought. You're not going to be surprised by what Jesus looks like because you've tasted of it now. See, you've already got you've been introduced in the gospel. You're introduced to the real Christ so that when the real Christ returns, you'll just see more of what you've begun to see now. But you're not going to be shocked by what you see. You'll be gladdened by it. He's everything the gospel says he is and more. Now, the objective is to not be rebukable. At that time. That's the aim. That, you might say, is the Great Commission. In fact, I've been thinking seriously, ever in a series of messages on great commissions of the Bible.
Amen.
And this is one of them. 1 Timothy 6:14-15. Keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable, until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which in his times he shall show, which is the blessed only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords. See, so you want to live, so Jesus doesn't have to rebuke you when he comes, because you're in for trouble if he does. And everything's in place. Right now, everything's in place for you to get loose from sin, get loose from the dominion of sin, get connected with Jesus, get acquainted with the things of God. Everything's in place in the great salvation for this to happen now, so that when Jesus comes, you'll be unrebukable. 1 Peter 4:13 tells us we're going to, now we have a joy unspeakable and full of glory, but what about then? Rejoice, inasmuch as ye are partakers of Christ's suffering, that when his glory shall be revealed, you may be glad also with exceeding joy. Yeah, that's what salvation sets you up for. You can imagine if a person's sad when Lord's Day comes, if they're sad when Sunday comes because they have to go to church. Is anyone dumb enough to think they're going to be happy to see Jesus when he shows up? If you notice, the closer you get to Christ, the more anxious you are to meet with his people.
Yeah.
That's just how it is. The people that aren't, they're just lying to us. They're lying to us when they say they love God. Just discard it. Put your fingers in your ears. Oh, this can't be so. They that feared the Lord meet often one with another.
Amen.
That's what the scripture says, Malachi 3:16 and 17. And what a meeting that's going to be when Jesus comes in all his glory, that we're all going to meet together.
Amen.
Never to part. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
For that. And one final thing here. When he comes now in all of his glory, then we're going to be like him, for we'll see him as he is.
Mm-hmm.
That's 1 John 3:2. In other words, the glory is going to transform us. The glory that destroys the heavens and earth is going to transform the people of God.
Mm-hmm.
The glory that's going to banish the wicked is going to transform the people of God.
Amen.
Now, actually, you begin, this transformation begins now within. You are as much like Jesus as you can see of Jesus. No more. No more. As much as you can see, that's what transforms you. Now, we know this is the case because 2 Corinthians, the third chapter, actually declares this and credits the work to the Holy Spirit of God. This is 2 Corinthians 3:18. But we all, with open face, that's without any obstructing vision, and beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image. See, so as you're looking at God's glory, it changes you.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say it this way. If you can see that God's gracious, you'll be gracious.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what happens. Mm-hmm. It's marvelous. And now it's going to be brought to its apex when Jesus comes in all his glory, all your transformation will take place, including your change of body. I find that to be a glorious prospect.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in conclusion, nature and the works of man will not be able to survive the revelation of Christ. So you don't want to become attached to them now.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone's going to have to let loose of whatever you have. You're going to have mm-hmm. to let loose of it.
Amen.
You're going to either have to let go of it when you die, and it's appointed unto man once to die, or let go of it when Jesus comes again. You're going to have to let go of it. So it's just good to hold it lightly. Don't get too attached to it. 2 Peter 3:10, the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which, that's in that day, the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, the elements shall melt with fervent heat, and the earth also and the works that are therein will be burned up. When's that going to happen? When Jesus comes as a thief in the night, and that's not in Tim LaHaye's book, Thief in the Night.
Mm-hmm.
That text isn't in there.
Hmm?
But it is here.
Amen.
It is here. And I will tell you that the knowing that Jesus is going to come in all of his glory with power and great glory is a tremendous incentive to holiness.
Amen.
Oh. I can remember as a young young preacher, and I'd separated from the world, but I was a little close to it. And I was about 20 years old, and one night it dawned on me the fact that when Jesus comes again, that's it. Mm-hmm. Just done. But I've never been the same since.
Amen.
It registered on my soul. This is true. When Jesus comes again, the heavens and the earth are going to flee away. The wicked are going to be scared and calling for rocks and mountains, and the righteous and godly are going to be happier than they ever been before. And there's going to be no question about who's coming and who's with him or where we're going. Or your reward, there'll be no question about it. And I bid you in Jesus' name to ponder these things. Ask the Lord to help you to see them. He can show them to you. See, he can unveil Jesus to you. Mm-hmm. And the reason you want to see him is so you can look at him. You've got to look to Jesus. And when you look to him, the clearer he becomes to you, the more you're changed and transformed. So it's maybe been hard for you to be godly or hard for you to have godly thoughts. The secret is not trying harder. That's mm-hmm. not the secret. I know. The secret is to see Jesus mm-hmm. as he is, and then he changes your character.
Amen.
God be praised for it.